So my name is Murray Hiebert from the Southeast Asia Chair here at CSIS. We're delighted you're all here. We have our first panel, which is going to talk about recent developments in the South China Sea. We're going to change the order up a little bit from what you saw in the program. Our first speaker will be Patrick Cronin, then Alan Dupont, then Dr. Thuy, and then Chris Johnson. But I'll introduce them as we go through the panel. So Dr. Patrick Cronin is a senior advisor and senior director of the Asia-Pacific Security Program at the Center for New American Security. Earlier, he was a senior director of the Institute for National Security Studies, National Strategic Studies at the National Defense University. For more details on his bio, you can look in their booklet.
Well, Murray, thank you, and Ernie and CSIS, congratulations on another tremendously attended conference. I've just flown in from Hawaii, so I apologize if I'm half asleep. What has changed, the update on the South China Sea from a U.S. perspective in the past year, is the deepening and persistent pattern of Chinese assertiveness, something I've called tailored coercion, and I was in Da Nang just a few weeks ago with Professor Jerry Cohen and Carl Thayer and a number of others, Greg Poling here from CSIS, and we had a long dialogue about this, but it's not just the oil rig, the reclamation of the Johnson South Reef, the assertiveness in the Second Thomas Shoal, the action since 2012, in particular at Scarborough Shoal, intruding into waters disputed with Malaysia, domestic legal enforcement regime that's been put in place, the concern about the East China Sea ADIZ, Air Defense Identification Zone, that might be replicated in the South China Sea, potential unilateral energy and resource exploitation and challenges to other portions of the nine-dash line area, including even possibly waters around Indonesia's Natuna gas field. So that's, in a nutshell, sort of a lot of the things that have happened in the last couple of years, that part of this really five-year pattern of more assertiveness on the part of China. It's complex. We heard a very pugnacious introduction from Chairman Rogers. He's getting down to the point about American commitment. I would, in my paper I've prepared, I'm fairly critical of China, but I do try to set it into a broader context, and including trying to understand what the Chinese are doing, and including their tremendous uncertainty internally. And internal security is a huge question for them. But bottom line, in fact, the United States does need to work with the region to figure out how to change the calculus. So I think on the fundamental point, I would agree with Chairman Rogers. Our aim in U.S. policy in general, and I'm not a policymaker, I'm a think tanker, but I think the U.S. policy overall is indeed still to expand cooperation with China and yet hedge. Unfortunately, when it comes to these gray zone areas where there's this tailored coercion, we're not having an impact, as Chairman Rogers suggested, on changing Chinese assertiveness. And so now the question is whether it's the East China Sea, South China Sea, different areas, but same kind of Chinese behavior, what is exactly the way to impose costs on bad behavior or not abiding by rules that are mutually agreed to? And that's sort of what I want to focus on, which is a few points for U.S. Thinking. And I guess, again, another change in the past year from U.S. policy perspective is simply that United States government is more serious this year than it was even a year ago about cost imposition strategies against bad behavior in the South China Sea. One, we have to keep engaging China, right? I mean, so the administration is right not to back off. This is persistent. This is going to continue. China is not going to be contained or isolated. We have to deal with China. We have to have a relationship with China. We know that. And we're going to seek a peaceful resolution to dispute in disputed areas. But we have to be firm at the same time that unilateral changes to the status quo through coercion or force should not be acceptable. And that's the area we have to work on. And so these other points basically try to truss up this response to tailored coercion. First, maintaining greater presence in and around the South China Sea. I think the United States is doing this. It's gradual. It's not a fundamental change, but it is a step up in U.S. presence. And we're doing this in a number of ways. We've seen the Enhanced Defense Cooperation Agreement with the Philippines. We've already continued to now deploy, we're now going to be stationed in a second littoral combat ship, up to four, potentially at Singapore. which is also an important hub for inclusive security dialogue, like the Shangri-La dialogue. We're expanding defense cooperation with Vietnam, and I've argued recently, and I would argue again today, for including lifting even the lethal arms ban on Vietnam, not because we have dramatic things we want to sell Vietnam right away, but I think it's an important symbolic step to start engaging Vietnam on that discussion. I think we need some muscle in our diplomacy to show that others are entitled to protect their interests as well. Not because we want them to go to war with China, but simply because we want to make sure that there are deterrents from assertiveness, and that people have to find diplomatic ways and legal ways to deal with their differences. We should be expanding cooperation with Malaysia and Indonesia. We're basically doing that, especially in the wake of the very contested election in Indonesia. It's going to be important to build on that. Countries outside of the South China Sea use the South China Sea. So India, Japan, Australia, others, they need to be part of this dialogue. The United States also needs to be following up, probably next year, on the future presence in Guam, training areas in the common wealth of Northern Mariana Islands, as well as Australia, where the air training fields are going to become more important than the marine presence in Darwin over time. And the next defense white paper that'll be out next year in Australia with the Abbott administration, I think will highlight and should highlight the alliance's importance as a regional public good, including in the South China Sea. Second thing we should be doing, this calculated shows of force. Not a big believer that this has a big impact, but there are times when having your presence around at a time when there's mischief going on, including largely surveillance, though, or port visits to countries, including allies, the way we had a submarine in Philippines during some of the Scarborough Shoal dust-up in 2012 in particular. More bilateral and multilateral exercises, naval, air, amphibious, law enforcement, all of these can be ways to demonstrate the U.S. operationalizing that presence. Talking about incremental changes, not fundamental big changes. Third thing is building partnership capacity. Again, this is ongoing. It's been ongoing for a long time, so it's not fundamentally new, but we're doing more of it. Coast Guard and law enforcement, maritime domain awareness, naval air professionalism, and then finally, regional efforts. So supporting ASEAN claimant cooperation, especially among Malaysia, as well as Vietnam, Philippines. Brunei would be nice, but I think they'll go along with those three if they can reach a conclusion about how to, for instance, support things like the international arbitration case. Supporting an ASEAN binding code of conduct, this is something that I think Carl Thayer will talk about. Keeping maritime issues on the ASEAN-centered institutions, such as the ASEAN Regional Forum, the ASEAN Defense Ministers Meeting Plus, the East Asia Summit. And finally, a regional information sharing regime based on airborne intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance. And Chairman Rogers hinted at this, but this is the time has come for this. We need to start basically declassifying really not very sensitive information. It's more abundantly available, and basically put everything on C-SPAN in the South China Sea, if you will, so that at least people are aware and can see what's going on and have information to debate what's going on. So that's why the footage of the fishing trawler, the Vietnamese fishing trawler that got rammed and sunk, seeing that was very impressive, just like the Japanese Coast Guard cutter that got rammed by a fishing trawler a few years ago, was also makes a case. I don't think the trend is very positive for the year ahead. I don't think that the tensions are actually going to subside. I don't think anything I've given you here is an answer in the next year to this problem, but I think it rebalances the U.S. ability to help shape and to help keep engaged with all of the key actors, including China, including our allies, including new partners like Vietnam, including actors outside of the South China Sea, to try to come to good order at sea, to try to come to the rules of the road, the inclusive, open, rules-based system we want. So thank you, and I'll be happy to expand in the Q&A. Thank you.
Sorry, apologies. Thank you very much, Patrick. Our next speaker is Dr. Alan Dupont, who is a non-resident fellow at the Lowy Institute for International Policy in Australia. He's also a professor of international security at the University of South Wales. Alan, please.
Sorry. Thanks very much, Murray. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I know that in Washington one has to keep things short and sweet, so I intend to do that. I have 10 minutes. I've been asked to talk about the perspective of the Philippines, Malaysia, Indonesia and ASEAN towards the South China Sea disputes. I'm not actually going to do that. I'm going to give you a couple of overarching comments about the significance of the South China Sea, and then I'm going to draw out some of the key points from the paper that I've written is available to you. I think the first point I want to make about the South China Sea is that Westerners generally have not appreciated the significance and the importance of the South China Sea, notwithstanding the fact that in recent years it's been in the news a lot. If you go back and have a look at writings about the South China Sea, you'll see that it's really from a very Eurocentric and Atlanticist perspective. You often see references to the South China Sea couched in European or North American terms. Nicholas Spikeman, for example, calls the South China Sea the Asia's Mediterranean, or others refer to it as the Chinese Caribbean. So I think this is not a very helpful way of looking at the South China Sea. One, because it devalues the significance of it, the fact that it's a completely different sea to the European hotspots that we're used to looking at historically. And most importantly, my argument is that the South China Sea has become the most important sea globally now, not only because of international trade flows, but also because of energy flows, and because of the strategic issues that are now at risk in the South China Sea over these disputed islands. So I think we need to elevate the importance of the South China Sea in terms of international perspectives and understandings about where the future hotspots of the world are going to be in the future, because this is not just a regional problem, it's going to be a global problem. If you think about those trade flows, if you think about the strategic issues at stake here, if there is a conflict, a serious conflict in the South China Sea, it is definitely going to have global implications. Because if you have any disruption of that trade through the Malacca Strait into the South China Sea, the implications will not be confined to Southeast Asia, I can assure you of that. And just to illustrate that point, the Malacca Strait has arguably become now the world's critical waterway. The amount of ore going through the Malacca Straits, by way of example, is about three times that of the Suez Canal and about 15 times that which flows through the Panama Canal. So I would argue that the Malacca Strait has become more critical than the Suez, Panama Canal and the Straits of Hormuz. Now, that is why these disputes over a group of really quite unprepossessing little islands and coral reefs has become so important. Because this is not just about territorial issues, about who owns these islands, but it's about if you own the islands, you own all the resources underneath the sea, not only oil and gas, but importantly, marine living resources, fish. Now, I wrote about this for the Washington Quarterly a few months ago, and I think this is one factor that's been missing in a lot of the conventional explanations about the drivers of conflict in the South China Sea, that fish is an important resource. It also feeds into the drivers of this conflict. But it's much more than territory, it's much more than resources. It's about the shifting power balance in the region. It's about China's rise. It's about increasing nationalism. And these are all playing out in the South China Sea because these island disputes have become triggers for a much broader conflict between the great powers in the region. So put simply, China clearly views the South China Sea as its sea, not just in name, but in fact, that it wishes to push the US out of that Western Pacific because it sees its rightful patronage as to dominate the South China Sea. So it's about China's rise, and it's about other countries resisting that rise, and that is why these disputes have assumed far greater importance than they would appear when you just look at them. By the way, can we have my first slide up? It's always useful to have a map up if we can get one. That's possible later on. Okay, I just want to draw out five big points about the conflicts in the South China Sea. My first one is that when you look at it from an ASEAN perspective, in the initial stages of the conflicts, much of the concern among the ASEAN states were about the intramural conflicts between the ASEAN states. remembering that there are four ASEAN states which claim islands and reefs in the South China Sea. So this was a big issue for ASEAN. But what became apparent to most ASEAN countries was that China was going to be the bigger long-term concern, simply because of its growing strategic weight and because it was showing a much greater degree of activism than anyone could have anticipated 10 or 15 years ago. So we've gone from concerns about intra-ASEAN cohesion and fragility being affected by these disputes to ASEAN concern about China's territorial claims in the South China Sea, which I think, as most of you know, covers almost 90% of the sea.
We finally have you up here.
Thank you. I'm afraid this doesn't come out quite as well with all these lights on, but anyway, it might give you some, when I start talking about a few of the issues here, it might give you some sense of the where they're located. The second point I want to make is that while Vietnam and the Philippines have been quite isolated in their attempts to elevate the South China Sea in ASEAN's concerns, I think that sentiment is starting to shift within ASEAN to take a more robust and more united position vis-a-vis China. Now, China has been very successful in picking off each of the ASEAN countries and bringing a lot of pressure to bear on them to either settle these disputes or to concede to China's claims. And China has been, as I said, quite successful in doing that over the last 5 years, but I think it's going to be more difficult for it to do in the future because the ASEAN countries are now becoming extremely anxious and insecure about some of China's, what I call, muscular unilateralism over the last couple of years. The third point I want to make is about Indonesia's position as the key swing state in ASEAN. Now, most of you know that Indonesia is not a claimant state to the Spratlys, but Indonesia does come into this dispute increasingly because it owns a group of islands called the Natuna Islands, which I'm afraid doesn't show up too well on this map, but it's in the southern part of the South China Sea, and the Indonesians now believe, and have come out and said this publicly, that China's territorial claims may actually intersect the exclusive economic zone of the Natuna Islands. So now Indonesia's interests are being engaged, and Indonesia, which has adopted a very softly approach towards China, is now starting to take a much more robust position in drawing China's attention to the fact that Indonesia is not going to resolve from defending its territorial claims in the Natuna Islands. The fourth point I want to make is that some ASEAN states are increasingly looking outside ASEAN for their counter strategies. Now, this is a very significant development given the broad consensus over the last 30 or 40 years within ASEAN that ASEAN must work together, consensus decision making, and a great reluctance to go outside ASEAN. I think that is starting to change, and you see this with Vietnam and the Philippines in particular, where they're now seeking to draw in other larger powers to balance China. And that's a shift that's starting to take place. The final point I want to make, and this will be my last point, is that while I do not believe that there is yet an arms race in Southeast Asia, there is no doubt that the militarization of the Spratly Island and the South China Sea disputes is of great concern to the region and is propelling and forcing countries to look at their defense spending, and particularly their spending on the maritime space. So we're starting to see ASEAN countries increase their defense spending, putting more money into maritime capabilities. And unfortunately, in my view, this is likely to worsen the disputes over time because the triggers for future military conflict are going to multiply and become more dangerous. So that is not a very positive development, but it's an understandable one if you're sitting in the shoes of the ASEAN states and you're looking at what China is doing in the South China Sea. So that's my final point. Thank you very much.
Great, Alan, that was great. Thank you very much. Our next speaker, and he's going to use PowerPoint, so can we get it up quickly? Our next speaker is Dr. Tran Truong Thuy, who is the research fellow and director of the Foundation for the EC as the Vietnamese call it. Some of us call it South China Sea Studies at the Diplomatic Academy of Vietnam. He's also Deputy Director of the Center for Foreign Policy and Regional Studies at the Diplomatic Academy. Dr. Thuy, over to you.
Good morning. It's a great honor for me to speak again here in the, I think, one of the most important conferences on the South China Sea issue. I will speak on some recent development in the region and provide some of my personal observation on its implications of the region. I agree with the chairman and also with previous speakers on the increasing assertiveness of China in the South China Sea in last year and in the first half of this year. And we can see China's deepening claims by scopes of its claims and also by sophisticated measures on the field, on the diplomacy, and also in domestic affairs. And if you see, for example, on the air, after establishing the ADIS in the East China Sea, China also announced the possibilities of establishing ADIS in the South China Seas. And to prepare for possible ADIS in the South China Sea, China is now invest huge resources on expanding the reef in Zhongshan to build an airstrip in the South China Sea. And if you see here, with the combination with airstrip in Goody Islands in the Paracels and airstrip in Spratly, China can provide air coverage for the enforcement of possible ADIS in the South China Sea. And also they conduct more offshore air patrols and enforce China maritime laws by the State Oceanic Administration. On the other hand, China also deepening the claims on the seabed. And little notice on this development. We can see China already publicly announced their claims on more than 200 ship grudge in the seabed of South China Sea. And they also claim to conduct archaeology in the South China Seas and plans to protect this size and in order to register maritime sea growth for UNESCO World Heritage. On diplomacy, China continue with divide and rule strategies, and we see more and more investment from China to offer economic incentives to Southeast Asian countries, especially to non-claimant countries. And you can see in recent 2 and 3 years, China offered a lot of initiative. For example, Maritime Sea Growth, Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank. China also offer upgrade China-ASEAN Free Trade Agreement, and also offer ASEAN-China Charity on Good Neighborliness and Cooperation. And I think it's that indication of China offer alternative for COC. And China also actively pushing diplomatic pressure to prevent ASEAN from forming a common position on the South China Sea issue. And they single out specific countries in specific terms. And you can see after Philippines, they turn to Japan. After Japan, they turn to Vietnam. And they try to single out specific countries. They don't want to deal with two or three countries at the same time. They continue with the cabbage strategy in the South China Sea for salami slicing, or as Chairman Mike Roger mentioned, just reef by reef and step by step. And we can see after Second Thomas source, we see new incident with Scarborough, where China fires water cannons on Philippines fishing boats. And we can see also the exercise, military exercise in James Shores. And we can see incident with the US ship Copans, the most near collisions in the between US and China since impeccable incidents. And China also increased military activities in the South China Seas. On the other hand, they also adopted a lot of domestic measures to strengthen their claims in the Chinese seas. For example, new passports with nine dash lines, shirt and boss rules, and fishing rules adopted by Hainan province. And they also announced new fishing bans. They also published a new horizontal maps with 10 dash lines. And you can see the map of China now is similar to the map of Southeast Asia already. And they also enhanced civil activity in so-called Sansa City. And if we put the recent incident into broader picture that we compute since 2007, we can see the continuation of China assertiveness on the South China Sea. Almost incident happened anywhere within the nine dash line with almost every country, Vietnam, Philippines, Malaysia, Indonesia, and the US also. But the turning point is the ongoing tension between China and Vietnam relating to placement of China deep sea drilling or rig within Vietnamese EEZ. This is a new level of assertiveness in various criteria. It's the first time China drilling in disputed waters. Before that, they just prevent other countries from conducting oil and gas exploration. But here is the first time China actually drilling in the continental shelf. And second is that it's a higher level of mobilization of protecting force. For the first time, they deploy more than 100 government and civilian ships to protecting the oil rigs from including military ships. And the first time, so long duration of tension, more than 3 months. And China continued with, and more in term of location, about ramming and water cannon firing tactics. And here's a video you can see China using water cannons
vào tàu Kiểm ngư 951, còn tàu kéo Tân Hải 285 sử dụng tốc độ cao đâm thẳng vào chính giữa mạn trái tàu Kiểm ngư 951.
Significant incident. And the position of parties regarding to this incident, China considers the parasols belong to China and China's sovereignty is indisputable. That the oil rig location is within contiguous zones of Triton Islands, the most southwest feature of parasols. Vietnam's position is that Vietnam has sovereignty over parasols and China illegally occupied parasols by force in 1974. And China drilling activity violates Vietnam's sovereignty rights in the area within its own EEZ measure from Vietnamese coastlines. And we can see some weaknesses of China's argument. First, the argument is that parasol is indisputable. We can see no affirmative evidence proving China sovereignty. Even China official maps until 1929 did not include parasol. And you can see two maps here, one by Western and one by China, official China maps in 1929. The most southern point is Hainan Islands. For Vietnam, Vietnam also maintained claims and so evident at least in 17th century. So two countries maintained claims in the region. So occupation by military force violates international law, of course. But here's also more significant is location of the rig is outside of parasol's waters. You can see here on the map the equidistant lines between Vietnam and China, and you can see the location of oil rig is on Vietnamese side of equidistant lines. And if, for example, if parasol can generate any kind of water, you can see also the location of oil rig is outside the waters of parasols also. So some observation, my personal observation, China approach a continuation of salami slicing strategy with more centralized and coordinated approach with garbage strategies, three levels of forces. And now we see some development is that state-owned enterprise is strategic weapons for foreign policy. And China now moving from reactive assertiveness to active aggressiveness. You see, in this incident, Vietnam did not conduct any activity before that. And the implication, deterioration of Vietnam-China relationship, because the implication for freedom of navigation, ASEAN is more concerned on the issue. And for the first time since 1995, they released a joint statement on South China Sea issue. And we see U.S. is more active in this region, in this issue, and U.S. position also have spillover efforts on influence on position of other parties. And Japan is also more active in voicing and in maritime cooperation with ASEAN claimant. And but so far, all of this coordinated or different approach did not could not prevent China from expansion. And we can see bilateral, multilateral approach are ineffective in preventing China. And we need, I agree with previous speaker, we need more creative thinking on that. We need concerted efforts to impose more costs for China. China calculation is based on cost and benefits in short term and long term. And in that aspect, ASEAN and US should take a lead on that issue with more coordination, with more rule sensing, and is including more engagement from US in this region. Thank you very much.
Dr. Thuy, thank you very much. Our next speaker is our colleague from CSIS, Chris Johnson. Chris is the Freeman Chair in China Studies here at CSIS, and he has spent, prior to coming to CSIS, he spent nearly two decades working in the intelligence and foreign policy communities here in Washington. Chris?
Thanks, Murray. And I'd just like to thank my fellow panelists. I think we had a really rich discussion this morning, and certainly that last presentation gives us a lot to think about in terms of what China's up to. I think what I'm going to try to do, and in order to be in keeping with Chairman Rogers' suggestion that we not leave any ideas in the pocket, so we want to get to the audience, actually, as quickly as we can, get you guys engaged. I'm just going to offer a couple of brief overview comments, and I'm going to try to focus not on some of these details, because I think they've been really well laid out already, but try to ways we can think about why the Chinese are doing this, and how we should think about how we should respond. And I think what's been driving my thinking on this recently is just that, you know, like any other problem one might look at as an analyst, I think you need to have an analytic construct that helps you filter the data to create some kind of a reality that it has some explanatory power with any luck. And so I'll be honest in saying I would differ slightly with Congressman Rogers this morning in terms of my core analytic construct has been with China on most issues that, generally speaking, they don't do things where they're shooting themselves in the face on a regular basis. They're generally pretty pragmatic in their approach, not wanting to create a lot of difficulty. And so when they're doing things like we've just been walking through that, at least to us, through our Western lens, seem so blatantly contradictory to their own interests and would seem to create a response in the region that is precisely the opposite of what they seek to have happen, I have to ask myself a couple of questions. I think one of those questions is, what do the Chinese know, or perhaps better, what do they assess that makes them think this is a good idea, when in fact I don't, or at least a viable idea? And two, and I think perhaps more worrisome for all of us if it's true, is this being driven by some sort of sense that the Chinese over time have begun to buy into a self-generated narrative about their rising power and influence in the region, and therefore that the kind of the sucking sound, if you will, of that phenomenon is sufficient to allow them to be very forthright in asserting their sovereignty and not face much of a response. So in recent trips to China, I've kind of asked these questions of people I was meeting with, and it was interesting. I got answers really in both of those directions, so it's kind of interesting. I guess I would just offer three sort of big points to help us think about how we would frame a discussion on this. The first, I think, that helps us understand why they're doing this is to acknowledge that this is a defined strategy, not a series of tactical developments or responses to things that the neighbors are doing or the U.S. is doing and so on. And so I think it's quite dangerous, actually, if we find ourselves focusing on the possible tactical motivations, such as, you know, CNOOC or others want to advance their commercial interests, or the military is fighting with the civilian leadership, or in fact has the civilian leadership on the defensive. I mean, my own view is this is just ridiculous given Xi Jinping's emerging power within the system. So we have to understand it as a strategy and as each one of these episodes linking together to advance that strategy. I don't think this is a blueprint, step-by-step, grand strategy of some sort where they know exactly each move they want to make, but there's an endpoint to all of this that is clear and obvious. So I think that's an important factor. The second, I think, frankly, is really to focus much more on this issue of the mind of Xi Jinping as the new Chinese leader. And I think that's very important now. I mean, myself as a sort of Morgenthau realist in terms of how I approach international relations, I don't like to dwell on pop psychology, but I do think with Xi Jinping, it's much more important, and it's more important precisely because he has accrued so much power to himself inside the system and has really changed the machine, if you will, of how the Chinese craft their foreign policy. And frankly, I think it's much more difficult, opaque system now than it was under his predecessor, Hu Jintao, who relied very heavily on the bureaucracy to get things done precisely because he didn't have a whole lot of intrinsic power to himself. And so I think in some ways, given that there were so many agencies in the know, if you will, about policy decisions, it was easier perhaps for those of us as researchers to be able to pick up a general picture of what was going on. My sense now is so much of what's happening in these incidents is she makes a decision, it's communicated to the relative, the related arm of the Chinese government, and it's executed. And so therefore, his thinking, his approach, I think, is much more important, perhaps, for us to focus on. So what can we say about his thinking on these issues? I think two points that I would just stress. The first is that I think Xi Jinping has a much more sort of ideological view of the world, of China's position in the world, than his predecessors have had. And you know, this is a difficult subject to sort of discuss here in Washington because sometimes we don't do nuance particularly well, and there's an interest to sort of say, oh, ideological, he must be a hardline communist, it's Mao Zedong, you know, that sort of thing. No, not at all. But he is a Marxist, and he looks at things in dialectical terms. And I think if you focus on and you think about things through a lens of historical determinism and the correlation of material forces and these kind of Marxist concepts, and you're China, you're feeling pretty good about your position. You don't see a real challenge to your position. And as my colleague Ernie Bauer is so fond of saying, in Asia, economics is security. And so to the degree that the Chinese feel that they're the only economic game in town, as Chairman Rogers said this morning, that I think makes them feel that the ASEAN countries, others involved, might complain a lot along this process, but ultimately they will sort of stand aside because of their dependence and interest in China's economic prospects. And so I really think this is where things like the Trans-Pacific Partnership, getting our own house in order here domestically to provide that alternative economic entity for countries in the region to be able to rely on reliably is very important. The second point I would make is just to note that it's also clear, I think, so far from his actions, that Xi Jinping's appetite for risk, both domestically and internationally, is much higher than his predecessors. I try to say that in a very value-neutral way. I think it's important that we not say that this is implicitly bad. I think it has a lot of potentially bad consequences, but right now it's just a statement to suggest that he has this higher appetite for risk, and we need to be aware of that. And my own sense is that when you combine that higher appetite for risk with what I described earlier about changes to the way foreign policy decisions are made, it means that indications and warning sort of indicators are much harder to see now and maybe much less likely. So for PACOM or for other folks who are tracking these developments, you may not have the kind of warning that you might have previously that something is about to happen. So I guess I'll wrap it up there, and we'll bring the audience in.
Excellent. Thanks a lot, Chris. Okay, so we've had four excellent panelists. They've thrown a lot of ideas out there. And so we're now over to you, the audience. If you have a question, we would prefer you have a question. If you have a statement, please keep it short and try to end with a question mark, if possible. So please identify yourself, and there are going to be mic runners who are going to give you the mic. Chris?
Thanks. Chris Nelson, Nelson Report. Just a quick comment and then a question. Just imagine if 5 years ago we had heard Chairman Rogers' speech. What would we be thinking? We'd all be going, holy cow, what a winger, you know? And now here we are listening to that, and we're following the analysis. We're all kind of there. You know, the discussions are about how do we counter these things, not, oh, my God, what are you talking about? You know, just 5 years ago. It's stunning, actually. And I think we need to remind ourselves we should be stunned by what's going on. My question, this is a constant chicken and egg. We all kind of agree that ASEAN and the Australians and Singapore and everybody, that they've got to act collectively in order to have a chance of an effective counter to China. But we also agree that, especially given the narrative of U.S. decline and some of the false lessons that are drawn from the Crimea and Syria and all that, that the U.S. has to lead in order to give the neighbors the power to do something. How do you bridge this gap? How do you, what do we need to be doing actively beyond some of the things we're doing? Is it time for a more active Seventh Fleet presence, a symbolic use of actual force, so to deter the possibility of having to actually use the damn force? Are we at that point yet? How do we work together? Who goes first? Can it only be collective, or must we go first? That's my question. Thanks.
I don't know. Patrick, that sort of seems to be your wheelhouse. Do you want to start?
Well,
jump in if you like.
Chris, this is an ongoing saga that I think will continue for some time, and I think it's going to take us multiple years to try to put in place a broader set of effective tools, bilaterally, multilaterally, including our relationship with China, to hopefully ratchet down some of the rising tensions that are complex that we've heard about why these are ongoing. So I've outlined some of those tools. I've even talked about flexing some muscle at the right time, but I don't think that, get into tactical solutions, I don't think that's a solution per se. I just want to give policymakers, I think policymakers need more leverage, more tools to gain leverage. And the participating, the claimant states themselves need more capacity for coastal air defense and Coast Guard law enforcement defense up to a certain point. Yes, that does introduce the complication of more triggers, as Alan pointed out, but I also think it introduces more deterrence. The United States, like every other country in this region, including China, is really less interested in conflict than it is with influence. And the U.S. doesn't have a particularly high appetite for confrontation on these issues, but it needs to be willing to accept some greater risk, including, those shows of force at the right time, to help dissuade Chinese leaders from thinking that this is an easy benefit, that is making the nine-dash line de facto reality.
Chris, I know you've probably heard this phrase, leading from behind, and I know it's been disparaged a lot in the US. It actually happens to be an Indonesian phrase, leading from behind, but there's a lot to be said for the US not being out in front on the South China Sea disputes. It's not saying you shouldn't perhaps nuance your strategy a bit more, and I can suggest some ways of doing that, but I think it would be a mistake for the US to leap out here and do exactly the things the Chinese are accusing you of doing. At the moment, if you look at this objectively, the US is really in a pretty strong position. You've got all the countries in the region pretty much lining up the US to hedge against China's rise. The region is doing a lot itself to respond, maybe not that effectively at the moment, but it's difficult for China to really get traction on this argument that you're trying to contain China when you look at what US policy responses have been over the last 3 or 4 years. So I would have thought you could achieve your strategic objectives, which is to maintain the safety of international sea lands, the global commons, provide support for your allies and friends in the region, but do it in a low-key, non-confrontational way, and be seen to be responding to requests from the region rather than the US pushing its own interests. That's the way I would go with the US strategy.
I'll just add a couple of points. I think, again, to think about it from sort of the 50,000 foot level, I think one of the issues, and it picks up on what Alan just said, is that while we do need to think carefully about how we approach it, ASEAN, I think, as demonstrated in an earlier round of this debate, needs a ringleader. It doesn't necessarily need to be the United States. It can be an ASEAN country. As Alan suggested earlier, the role of Indonesia, I think, is very interesting going forward. But there needs to be some sort of an organizing presence, and I do think that for good or for ill, they do look to us to play that role. Regardless of whether that's the case or not, whether we deserve the influence we have or not, they do watch what we do and listen to what we say very carefully on these issues, as do the Chinese. So my feeling is that if you want to get this right, the first big step is to make sure that everything you're saying and doing is being crafted and thought about in the context not just of the political or the particular bilateral relationship you might be focusing on because of a presidential trip or something like that at that given time, but how that decision is going to be viewed by the other players in the region. And that requires, I think, then a lot of pre-briefing and post-briefing of allies about what we're doing, because if you don't, then those countries will do what we all do, which is to craft their own narrative to explain what's happening. And as we all know, that when we're crafting our own narrative about something, it's usually the darkest possible narrative possible.
Michael?
Michael Yehuda from GW. I think in the last week or so, there's been signs of usual commentators, academics, and think tankers in Beijing talking to Western reporters in a rather questioning way about the way China has behaved. And one at least has said that the United States should in some sense show that China has to pay a cost for its behaving. Others have raised questions about the fact that Asians do not seem to accept the official Chinese view about its history of humiliation and so on. Now, I'd be interested in how the panelists assess this and whether or not they see this as some kind of domestic constraint upon China's recent actions.
I think I've been reading the same articles you have, and one thing that struck me about them, while given anonymously in a few cases, was how these Chinese think tankers, I think primarily, have been suggesting that there's a debate, or at least some criticism inside the system about whether or not this is the right approach. And that's pretty rare for them to do that, especially with Western journalists. So I find that to be very interesting. I'm not sure the debate matters that much, because I think those comments tend to conclude with, but the boss has decided this is the way we're going to do it, and we don't really have a choice. So I think that's an important factor to underscore, but it does suggest that there are at least some inside the system who are sort of wondering, just like we're all wondering, whether or not this is ultimately going to backfire on the Chinese. And we hear a lot of discussion about the scoring of own goals and this sort of thing. I just like to emphasize that relying on the other side to consistently score own goals is not a strategy. It's wishful thinking. And also, I think that we should keep our minds open to the idea that indeed they may not be scoring own goals on themselves, and they know exactly what they're doing with this strategy because they think it will be effective. I mean, I think we have to at least keep our minds open to that possibility.
We've heard some very valuable introductory remarks, and I just want to try to get the speakers to broaden it even further. We're concerned with trends. I'd like to see where you think the South China Sea strategy, and you're right, it is a strategy, fits into China's overall foreign policy and its domestic policy. For example, it's obvious that Hong Kong is going to be a crisis soon. Taiwan, 2 years down the road, will once again become perhaps more important than the current concerns over what are still just piles of rock. With Ma stepping down, it's going to be very hard, whoever succeeds him, to continue the success, cross-strait agreements, et cetera. When we look at China's domestic policy, we see Xi Jinping is indeed a high roller, a risk taker. He's engaging in more repression than we've seen his predecessors engage in. Can you relate the South China Sea strategy to these other emerging trends as well as to the East China Sea? How broad can the picture be meaningfully made?
Sure. And no, I did not pay Jerry to ask that question, just just so we're clear. I hope I didn't misspeak in my opening remarks. I wasn't simply trying to describe a South China Sea strategy. It's a comprehensive foreign policy strategy. When I say there's a defined strategy, I mean in toto. And the East China Sea and the South China Sea are linked. The behavior there clearly is linked. If we look at, again, my concern is that if we focus on tactical explanations for individual episodes, you're going to miss the big picture, you know. And if your construct is wrong, you're going to have wrong conclusions and therefore wrong policy recommendations. You asked if I could tie the domestic situation to this foreign policy strategy. I could very easily do that, but I tend to disagree with that sort of thinking, that somehow their concerns about the economy slowing and the need for distraction with bread and circuses and so on is driving this foreign policy. To me, that's wrong. Because again, it tends to cheapen the idea that, no, it's a defined strategy for its own purposes. The domestic obviously influences the external, but I don't think it's being driven by that. What I think we see is the parallelism in the way Xi Jinping is running the country, both domestically and abroad. And one key theme to kind of tie the two together is that he's trying to pursue a series of reforms that are very, very hard, that are have lots of opponents inside the system. This is true domestically, but people forget that the third plenum document last fall also had a lot of reforms of the judicial system, social reforms, military structural reform, which I think is playing a very big part in what's going on in their external behavior. And there seems to be a sense that's developing that because these challenges are difficult, to be able to justify what he wants to do and get people on board, he needs to create a certain sense of urgency or crisis with regard to both the domestic situation and the external situation. So in terms of how we can understand that as outside observers, I guess one of my points would be, what does it mean for the rest of us, including the regional claimants and everyone else in the region, that Xi appears to have concluded that he needs to maintain a certain level of tension, both domestically and externally, in order to be successful with what he's trying to do. On your points about Hong Kong and Taiwan, I agree completely. I think Hong Kong is headed in a very dangerous direction, in part because Xi Jinping seems to take a much harder view on Hong Kong than his predecessors. I tried to get to the bottom of why that is. It's been hard to do. I do find it interesting that his father was the party secretary in southern Guangdong province when in fact Hong Kong was a hostile base of subversion. The British were running in folks from there and so on. I do think if I'm sitting in Taipei and I'm watching what's happening in Hong Kong, I do find myself saying, why is one country, two systems a good idea? It's kind of difficult to see. We'll see whether they do the right thing on universal suffrage or not. But all these things certainly should be seen as a cohesive net. And I think the way to tie it all together is Xi Jinping's idea that it's about the party and its continued hold on power, and it's about China's return to a great power status. And as such, they're going to exercise their behaviors both internally, externally, as if they are a confident, strong, great power. I think that's the best way to try to tie it together.
Can I just add a couple of points to Chris's analysis? I think he's absolutely right on those questions, but I'd say from a broader strategic perspective, I think the South China Sea has become a critical element of Chinese strategy. for a couple of reasons. One is, if you look at their last 2 5-year plans, you'll see they've given great emphasis to the maritime domain because essentially the South China Sea has become the major conduit and maritime highway for China's future economic growth. All the resources it needs, the energy and so on, have to come through that sea. It's become critical to Chinese thinking, whether it's economic or geostrategic. Secondly, you're aware of the fact that the Chinese and Hu Jintao in particular have referred to the Malacca dilemma. That is, the concerns that in a future conflict with the United States, for example, that the US may choose to cut off the flow of goods to China through the Malacca Strait. And that's been specifically mentioned, and PLA strategists look at this now all the time as to how they can find ways around that. So I think if you see it in terms of their military strategy, they're putting enormous resources into their maritime capabilities. They're not doing that just for fun. They're doing that because that's where they see the most likely sources of contention. These are the vital sea lanes for China, and they're tired of outsourcing Chinese economic security to the US 7th Fleet. They want the PLA fleets down there providing protection for Chinese goods and energy. So I think all those factors play into Chinese strategic thinking about the importance of the South China Sea.
Can I just throw in one more comment on that? Because I think what Alan just said is really important. The other piece here is, you know, we're kind of, as Chris was saying earlier, we're sort of saying, ooh, what happened here? What's going on? You know, this is very shocking and so on. They've actually told us exactly what they were going to do, starting from the 18th Party Congress in 2012, wherein the work report, the political work report that the predecessor, Hu Jintao, delivered, said China is now is a maritime power, right? And people say it's one sentence, who cares? They hadn't said that for several hundred years. So, you know, they were very clearly indicating a direction with that. They also said in that document that the size and composition and so on of the People's Liberation Army should be consistent with China's growing national power and strength and interests abroad. That's a pretty broad sort of definition for how you're going to build your military. And then Xi Jinping himself has held several of these Politburo level study sessions on the maritime issue where he's also been very clear about the direction. So to me, they haven't been exactly hiding how they're thinking about this issue, and we should read what they say very carefully.
My name is Nguyen Ngoc Bích with the National Congress of Vietnamese Americans. I have a remark and then a quick questions addressed to Dr. Chen Chung Thuy. My remark is that we are sometimes trapped by our language. By calling this massive international water the South China Sea, somehow it predisposes people to think that somehow it belongs to China. Whereas even the Chinese name for it, Nanhai, doesn't say anything about China, it just says Southern Sea. So I think that's why there's a Vietnamese foundation, it's called the Nguyen Thai Học Foundation, that has been circulating a petition. It says now received over 100,000 international signatures calling it the Southeast Asian Sea. I think that we probably can have consensus on that. So that's one issue. The second issue is that we are also trapped by our representation. The Chinese, I think the weakest claim of the Chinese to that sea is their so-called 9 dotted line. It started out as 11, and then it becomes 9, recently becomes 10. So I think the responsibility of the Chinese government is to try to define what does that mean? If this discontinues, so then what does the discontinued part means? Do they claim to the discontinued part or only those that are has a line? And so by representation, as we saw in Dr. Thuy's representation, as a continuous line, or as you even see in Vietnam, know you, it's a continuous line. I think we are giving the Chinese some credit because they themselves do not claim to the whole continuous line. Why should we give it to them that advantage? Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Thuy?
Yeah, thank you for the question. First, on the name of the sea, I think The name is not indication of sovereignty over the sea for China. For example, Gulf of Mexico is not belong to Mexico, or Gulf of Thailand is not belong to Thailand. So for international audience, of course, we use the more widely known name of South China Sea. Of course, for Vietnamese, we call it Vietnam Sea, East Sea in Vietnam. Yeah, sorry. It's Vietnam Sea in Vietnam. Regarding to the China nine dotted lines, first, we don't have any clear explanation from China on the meanings, especially the meaning of the nine dotted lines. We talk a lot with Chinese scholars and officials, and they give different meanings on the nine dotted line. Either it's a line to indicate the sovereignties over islands, or the line to indicate the waters within the lines. But since 2009 and 2010, after the communication regarding to joint submission of continental shelf between Vietnam and Malaysia, and when China attached a map to United Nations, we see China is more clearer in defining the lines. Now they are more rely on the concept of sovereignty over islands, also on exclusive economic zone and continental shelf of islands. And besides that, also they claim the historical rise of the, for China in resources exploitation, either fish or oil and gas. But more important, I think, is not about China claims, but about China activity within the nine dotted lines. And as I mentioned in the map, we see a lot of incidents, a lot of activities that China conducted within the lines. And in reality, they want to change the nine dotted line to de facto China waters and turn the South China Sea into China Lake. So I think in my map, I also draw the dotted line. And it's maps just for illustration and not for claiming something.
Hi, my name is Paul Pham from the Federation of Vietnamese American Communities of the USA. We all know that China and Vietnam are allies for a long time, and Vietnam depends heavily on China trade. But Vietnam doesn't have a defense agreement with the United States. In the case of Vietnam request or ask for help from the United States, will the United States be willing to trust Vietnam enough in order to help Vietnam? Secondly, the United States behave differently or act differently on several cases. The United States did not respond on the China invasion of Paracel Island in 1974. And the United States did not respond concretely on the China occupy of Scarborough Reef of Philippines. But the United States support completely the case of Senkaku of Japan. So the question is that, will Asian country trust the United States' determination in helping them to protect themselves? Thank you.
Patrick, maybe that's in your
sure.
wheelhouse.
And I deal with this issue in part in the paper that I've written that should be circulated later. It's a fair question. It's obviously the context of history matters a great deal. So let's take the Senkaku Diu Island issue. This was part of the Okinawa Prefecture from the U.S. perspective post-World War II. U.S. occupied Japan and Okinawa, and it was only negotiated the reversion of Okinawa and Okinawa Prefecture in 1971 to begin in 72. and under the mutual security treaty with Japan, territories occupied or administered by Japan are included under Article 5 of the treaty. So it's a statement of fact that the United States has, over time, with an ally, Japan, reverted territory back, said, you're now administering this territory, and yes, it's included in the alliance. So that's sort of a statement of fact. It's also true that we were fighting a war in Vietnam, and then we were losing that war and retreating from Vietnam, and there were much higher stakes in the Cold War that Dr. Kissinger and others, and these are documented, and I cite some of the documents that have been declassified in my paper, basically sided completely with being soft on China, because China was a valuable sort of partner in breaking what we thought was a consolidated communist phalanx with the Soviet Union. And it was in that division, that separation, that Sino-Soviet separation was strategically valuable at the time. So that was the context in which 74 parasails, we looked the other way, essentially. As did other countries. Indonesia thought they had private agreements with Zhou Enlai. And it's only recently now, as we've just heard, that they're wondering whether those agreements really still stand right now, because it's not as clear. So we're all reinterpreting China in the context of a risen China, China that is has risen so quickly, has so much more capacity, and so much more capacity than its neighbors, and yet is trying to exert economic and political influence as well, perhaps in line with more historical context or framework, that we're concerned about this. So now we do want to increase the U.S.-Vietnam security relationship, and that went through a period of normalization. That took time. Went through a period of creating a serious strategic dialogue and returning with port visits. That's taken time. And I think this next phase needs to step up a notch, and it will take time, but it will not be an alliance. We will not look for bases, right? But we can increase engagement. We can increase, as I mentioned, arms sales, potentially, especially ones that are oriented toward maritime information, intelligence, security of defense. Just as we support what Japan is doing in terms of patrol boats, for instance, to Vietnam, and we want to see that turned back on as quickly as possible. There has been a concern over corruption on the defense, on the development assistance count. Anyway, so it's not going to be a guarantee, but there's going to be willing support, and going back to Alan DuPont's admonition, U.S. is responding to what we're hearing out of Hanoi. We're responding to what we're hearing out of Manila. The United States is not suddenly pushing this approach. We are indeed responding to this, and we do have to, if not lead from behind, because that's a phrase that does not go well in Washington, we are listening and working with others, right, in the region, and that's important. So Vietnam is a critical partner. I think it's going to be a more important partner in the decade ahead than it has been even in the past.
James.
Hi, James Manicum from CG. Could I just ask the same question to you, Dr. Truong? What's the Vietnamese perspective? What are you prepared to accept from the United States in terms of support? What are the limits? I mean, your country has a long tradition of an independent foreign policy. How much U.S. assistance will your country accept?
I think we should put the U.S. within the broader picture of foreign policy of Vietnam, of diversification and multilateralization of Eastern relations. Vietnam, since 1986, adopted this kind of policy to expand relationship with own countries, including major powers. But in that aspect, I think U.S. is now play more and more important roles in foreign policy of Vietnam, in security and also development aspects. And in South China Sea issue, I think Vietnam and U.S. share a lot of common interests in South China Seas, namely respect of international law, freedom of navigation, peaceful settlement disputes, ASEAN centrality role, and also that China rise will be peaceful. It's one of that is share common interest. On practical aspect, I think U.S. and Vietnam have a lot of things to do in improving cooperation in just aspects. But of course, I don't expect that Vietnam and U.S. will become allies in this aspect because of a lot of issues. But until the level of ally, I think a lot of issues we can develop, including military, paramilitary, economic aspect, law enforcement capability. And I think in that aspect, economic and law enforcement capability, I think the most important one in terms of South China Sea issues. Pacific fleets or seven fleets travel around South China Sea, but it will not create any significant impact on current contest for resources in the region. It's mainly between law enforcement agencies within claimants countries. And China Coast Guard is far away from that, and U.S. cannot interfere on the contest of the issue. But on economic aspect, I think U.S. can play more and more important role. U.S. now puts more important on TPP negotiation, but I think it's still a long time of negotiation, still a long time to come. But on bilateral economic relation, I think we can improve a lot. And as demonstrated in the case of Philippines, after Philippines and China tension after Scarborough incident, for example, China imposed economic sanction on Philippines, but U.S. and Japan promote cooperation with Philippines, and we see now Philippines now economic growth is more, even higher than previous tension. So by that way, U.S. can promote diversified economic relations with Vietnam and strengthening Vietnam overall capability in dealing with China. Thank
you. So unfortunately, the time is up for this panel. I see there's many questioners still out there, but we're having a day and a half of meetings. I'm sure you'll have a chance to ask your questions in the other panels. Please, we're going to pause now for 5 minutes to transition this panel to the next one. But before we do that, please join me in thanking Dr. Thuy, Patrick, Chris, and Alan. Thank you.